concepts that we're, I'm going to detail are events and callbacks. I think events would be pretty simple to understand. Callbacks cause a lot of confusion, whether you're new or coming from another language. So we'll get into both of those. Anybody got questions about people who use callbacks, seen callbacks, know what callbacks are?
Seeing them in the Learn You Node workshop thing and makes my brain hurt because I've never done it before.
So while it's waiting to load, I'll do some code, some sample code. We'll have a function here. Equals function data.
It's part three. Is that something you can change?
Try. This function, and now if I want to use it, so this is something that you might see, and that's why I'm writing it like this. This might look familiar. This example is not going to be the best, but what you can see here is that there's kind of like a figure eight going on between the functions. Calling this function and you're passing an argument of a function. So the reason why this might look confusing is because it's actually it's nested syntax. You're getting nested syntax. You've got we're calling function, which would normally look like this, you know, arg1 and arg2. Those are your arguments. What's happening here, and you see this in demonstrations all over the place, is in place of one of these arguments that you might pass to your function, they just write the function longhand right there in the middle. So you can see, calling the function right there, everything's happening in the arguments. Place where you put the arguments for the function. And that's lazy, confusing, sometimes useful, totally legal. But another way to do it might look something like this. So this is another way of looking at it. This is cleaner. You can see now I'm still passing two arguments to function. one of them is this thing I declared up here called CB, which is function. So it's very common to pass a function as an argument to a function. That's what callbacks are. You can see in this, when I declared this function, I said, well, this function is going to, it's expecting to see, one argument called data. We're calling it data. That's just, you know, the variable that you're applying to the argument. You can call it whatever you want. And down here, we're just passing the function. We're no longer doing that thing where that all of this syntax was nested inside of the function call itself. Is this understood? Any questions? Yeah.
How would you assign to the variable CB, or to any variable, the value that this function returns?
Which, for this one, for this function, or the other function?
Like you have CB equals function of data. How would you, if that function returns some value, how would you assign that to a variable?
Okay, so returning values is something you can do in functions, and is something you often do, but it's not something you have to do. So I didn't have a return statement here, you can see, but I could say return
callback.
And over here I could say return data, but there wouldn't really be any point to that. However, up here there might be a point to it. You could return data, and then when you call the function, I could say, varg equals whatever. And so now up here, returning this function now returns something and calls a callback. So it's going to call the callback. So this line right here is going to execute before this is returned, which means that this is going to execute before this data is returned, which means before D has been defined.
Okay.
So now, and we'll see this if I say, so we should see this console log first, followed by this one. So this was just to get over, this was just to point out this kind of syntax-y thing that goes on that you see very often when you've got callbacks. And the reason why this is important is because so much of Node, so much of JavaScript requires callbacks because things don't happen in time. But this gets into events, so it kind of works backwards. Let's see if my thing loaded here. Node 101. Is a little thing I wrote. I guess we'll wait a few more minutes for that. Let's get into events real fast. So events are a very core part of Node. It's like the most fundamental class of construct on top of, you know, plain JavaScript. If you've heard of streams, and you'll definitely hear of streams in Node. Sorry, there's people here. Streams are built on top of events. And to me, events are just really kind of a fundamental concept of programming, especially if you're working with user interfaces, people typing, clicking, scrolling, swiping, things like that. Those are all events. And so you can see, you can read this on your own. I'm going to scroll through it just to cover some things real fast, and I'll go back to some code. But this many people are like questioning, like, should I use Node in my career or whatever? Like, should I learn Node? Should I be learning Node? Should I be learning JavaScript? Hand in the air. I want to know who you are. All right, these are the ones. People who are like considering Node and JavaScript, are you coming from another language or coming from nothing? Coming from another language? Yeah, which one?
Ruby.
Are there previous languages?
Python.
Python.
A little bit of everything.
A little bit of everything.
English.
A little nothing. JavaScript and English are both very meta, so I like it. Okay, so I'm going to talk. This talk was supposed to be a little bit about Node via events and callbacks because they're fundamental things. So for everybody here, Node doesn't run in the browser. Node doesn't run in websites. I get questions like this all the time, how do you use Node in my website, in my browser? It's a real newbie kind of mistake to think about it because it's not exactly, it might not be well understood how Node differentiates from like websites and browsers and things like that. So that's where we start off in our little journey here, which is about computer programs running in many host environments. It's useful for programs to be able to run across many different types of operating systems and environments. JavaScript runs inside of every tab of every website. That's where JavaScript originally is from. It's still there. Node is not in the browser. It's like it's almost like a browser itself for your operating system. So Node created an environment for running JavaScript outside of the browser, which is great. So it's it's the one you can run inside and outside of the browser, but it's just a whole different bunch of stuff you can do with Node that you can't do in the browser. And it was originally written for building the back ends of web apps. That's what it's built for. It's built for being high performance web app back end, serving files, streaming things between users and databases and such like that. That's what it's built for, and that's what it's really good at. And it works very well for what it was intended, writing web server applications, aka the backend. But it performs really well in a lot of other respects. If you define well as being able to build things fast, being able to utilize a lot of open source technologies and things like that. You can build command line applications like you've started to learn how to use with Node in a really easy way. Using JavaScript, not using Bash, you can build command line apps to do very simple things. As you proceed with programming, you tend to start writing these types of things because you have a particular itch to scratch, and this is one way to do it. So Node is good for that. It wasn't intended to do that, but the ecosystem that has been built around it by a lot of sort of slow baking in a large community has made it really useful for building things besides web server applications. And Node, in turn, because it created a very nice environment for this stuff, has influenced front-end application building, the stuff inside the websites. I know a lot of people are interested in front-end technology, building interfaces, websites and stuff. The conventions of Node influence that, as you'll see, we'll some of those later. Anyways, so one of the core concepts of Node is events, and that's kind of because it's kind of built into JavaScript. As I said, if you're working with lots of user inputs, that's basically events. Interactions are events. Therefore, JavaScript has always been event-oriented. A lot of other programming languages, people coming from other programming languages tend to have a real beef with JavaScript, this callback stuff, this evented stuff, because it's just not, you kind of have to, it's the way you write things. It's like, oh, I don't want to write my poetry in pentameter, but it's like, well, you have to write programs a little bit different if you're dealing with asynchronous events. You're writing a program now that's going to deal with somebody potentially clicking this or swiping this or, you know, sending this message, receiving this data. These are all just events, and that's a lot of what you're programming for in JavaScript. A lot of constructs are built on top of events because they're so low level, like streams, which James will be talking about later this week, I think, are built on top of events. So a click is an event, a connection, an update, intervals, these are events. To me, this is kind of like also basic to programming because this has always been like my paradigm. How many people have heard of like MVC, model view controller? Like you're like, oh, I want to build a web app. And it's like, and you start looking at like some of these frameworks and libraries that are like, well, use the MVC pattern. It's the model view controller pattern. And you build models and views and controllers, and you never understand what any of them are. Because I never understood them, I just stayed away from it. And I just hacked around in the browsers forever, and I realized that events are the thing. So, you know, in model view culture, they have this thing like data binding. You have something, and this is the data. And if it changes, you know, like that data, that like something has to be bound to that change. And the controller knows about that and tells the view to change or something like that. But it's just kind of a silly abstraction to me because the changing of data is an event. You know, you get a new post from a friend, or you know, you perform some change on some data, or you know, they click and change red to blue. So it's just events, and I build a lot of front end applications, and it's all mostly built around this kind of events. And then some events you can even break down into smaller parts, like a button. A button is pressed, the button is held, the button is released. These are events. A connection is opened, a connection is upgraded, a connection is closed. These are all events. And so you might have a different directive for each event, or one thing for all of them. So streams are often built on multiple types of events. Open up the stream. The stream emits a data. The stream emits pause. The stream emits go ahead. The stream emits close. The stream emits destroy, and things like that. So streams are ways of putting together lots of events into a particular flow that you need. So how do you write programs that anticipate various events and then does something with the potentially unknown consequences of these events, such as an error or the receipt of arbitrary data? There's one answer. You must write functions that listen for various events, and then you write functions that handle the results of these events when they occur. So the first kind is called, let me repeat that. You write functions that listen for events, and then you write functions that do something when that event happens. And the first one is called a listener, an event listener. And the second one is the callback. So you often see frameworks, the two environments, Node and the browser, are both evented. So that you're it's like the very relationship of the JavaScript code you're writing to the environment that you're writing it in is the event. So you know, you see in a browser, I could say window add event listener. So that's the listener. That's all it is. It's what I do with the event. Sensors or users pressing buttons or receiving data, then that's what you're looking for. And I know, like, that's the so it's funny because I was like looking at, and I was one time thinking about getting into iOS development or whatever, and I was looking at like their requirements, and it was like, oh, you've got this MVC pattern, but it's like, and there's like these drawings of like the model view controller, and I just like saw it as like a field of like whatever. There was, and then they were like, oh, but there's also these things, and they stuck up like these towers, and it's like, this one emits an event, and over here, this one catches events. And it's like, well, that's like fundamental, you know, that like everything was built around the ability for these things to like catch and receive events. What was all this other like model view stuff for? Marina?
I have a question. So the first argument, click, is that like a built-in, or like how do you know what the types of events are that you can?
So the question is, how do you know what kind of events are built in? And what was the second part of that?
Yeah, like, do you define what click is, or is that something that already exists?
For events.
Yeah.
Right. So in this case, we're dealing with one that already exists.
Okay.
A click event is so window. So right now I switched context. Right now I'm in the browser. Both browser and node have the concept of events. They differ slightly, but it's totally trivial how they do. So I'm going to do like right here. This is the exact same structure that I was showing you before. We have a listener that takes a string for the first argument, which declares the type of event to listen for. This stuff is all on Mozilla's developer network, you know, reference docs, adding event listener to objects in your DOM. I'll open up this down here. Window is the top level thing in the DOM. There, below it is the document, and below that is the body. And there you can see the HTML for this website. This website at Node Module Club is one that I use. I wrote it. It's kind of like what's going on down here. You know, I can say var x equals 2 and say x plus 2 and it returns 4. Or I can say console log. So we got four because it console logged what I said, and we got undefined because console log did not return a value, so it technically returned an undefined value. Anyways, the point is that down here in the bottom part, I'm in a sort of REPL. I can type code, I can interact with the website. The same thing is happening up top, but it's got some bonus things in it. But see, so up here, I'm going to add an event listener to the window object. The window object has this method on it called addEventListener. All HTML elements have now, what I, again, back to what the function that I wrote, I called the event listener click, and then the second thing I passed to it is console log. What is console log?
Function.
A function. Console log is a function that takes arbitrary arguments and spits them out down below, where you can debug them and see, you know, why, you know, see what's happening. So, when I click up here,
friends on the console log.
No, but I wonder if, so now I'm going to do that ugly thing that I said, you know, you see all over the place, where you just go right into the, no, I'm not, I'm going to say callback, I'm going to do it this the nice way.
Yeah.
Callback. So now below, I'm going to do this a little bit differently. This is different from, how I declared the function. Previously I had done declared functions above using var. There's this other way to do it, which is to do it below and put a name after the function. Essentially the same thing, but this has they have implications. Some of them are just nice for scanning code and understanding how things work. I don't know if the error was caused because I was typing on, because I called the event listener on the window, or what. I don't know why. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put it on the document body, and we'll see. Of information about what happened, when the click occurred, where, on what element, a whole bunch of other information, and hopefully we don't get a bunch of errors now. So there we go. Remember back when I made the other event listener and it caused errors? Well, it's still live. That event listener is still live, so we're still getting the errors. But we're getting these mouse events now, because they're click events that are of the type mouse event. It occurred at 256 pixels from the left and 84 pixels from the top. There was probably a timestamp. This is when it occurred. That's how many milliseconds since 1978 occurred. And all kinds of other things. In the browser, you're going to deal with all kinds of elements, or all types of events. Clicks, key down, key up, drag, drop, animation start, on API docs, chew 20 times, come back and check later. Events equals acquire, events, event, emitter. So, these are the docs for Node. We have events. These are built-in modules. This is stuff we'll be getting into probably within like next class or next talk about it. Whoa. Back over here. So now I say var inventor equals new events. Let's just make sure this works. Because they're built into Node, you don't have to download anything. Anybody used intervals and timeouts yet? Set interval, set timeout. Anybody not know what intervals and timeouts are? Yeah. Another pretty common concept. I'm gonna do a timeout. A timeout is wait a certain amount of time and then do something. Set timeout also takes a callback. Okay, so what's happening here with set timeout? Set timeout is built in. It says at 5,000 milliseconds, after 5,000 milliseconds, do something. In this case, the thing it's going to do is do something. Do something is a function. So it's sort of the same as the callback that's happening up here, which says, eventer, when you hear the event called Johnny, do callback. And callback has been defined down here. So, eventer, when you hear Johnny, do callback. After 5,000 milliseconds, Eventer emit. So here it's emitting an event. This is sort of the opposite end of events. Most events you work with will be supplied by the website itself, the person clicking, Node, somebody makes a connection, or whatever else. In this case, I'm actually just going to tell it when to emit an event. This could be useful for all kinds of reasons, as you'll see later.
Is the time
timeout from when node starts? Is it like, is it from when timeout is invoked, or is it from when the program is executed?
I don't think there.
Wait. The question. It seems to me like it's in the global scope, right?
Yeah.
So they may be called like, even though this is when. Is it? It seems like it may be. It could either be executed just globally, because what if a callback sets a timeout, and then it happened outside the time when the program returned.
So it's going to happen 5,000 milliseconds roughly after this. This is a function being called. Yeah. Set timeout is a function. We're calling that function. Roughly 5,000 milliseconds after that is when it's going to happen. But you could put a set timeout anywhere, you know, 100 years down the lifetime of your program, because you could say, listen for, you know, you could write a program that's listening for intelligent life in space. And you could say, when you get intelligent life from space, emit Eureka. We got it. So, wait 5,000 seconds, 5,000 milliseconds after we get report of intelligent life to let it sink in. Then, emit Eureka. I think this program will work. Let's see. Module I need to require is called events, not event.
Yay.
Any questions about how that worked, why, you know, the way that it's structured? Is this possibly any more like clear about like callbacks and like how, yeah?
Why do you need to do new events?
Do what?
Event or equals new events, the second one.
Okay. So I believe you guys talked about constructors before. Constructors, if you're coming from another language, you might have another name. Factory, maybe? I don't know. So what this module is returning up here in the first line is a constructor. It creates event emitters. You can write 1,000 of them. They're very lightweight. You know, it's just an event emitter. It's pure JavaScript code. There's nothing fancy to it. It says, you know, it lets you do these things. It lets you declare arbitrary events for listening to, and emit arbitrary events. If I emit an event and I don't listen to it, nothing will happen. It'll emit the event, but there will be, you know, nothing to listen to it. So what's the question was, why did we have to do this right here, new events? And that's because this is a constructor. Events is a constructor. It creates new event emitters. I called it an eventer, but it might have been better to call it this one event emitter. You can see up in the first line, there's actually a class right here, event emitter, that we're tagging on to the end. Another way to write it would be like event emitter constructor equals events dot event emitter. So events equals the module events, built into Node. Don't have to download anything. It's there. It's fundamental. And then up here. New event emit constructor event emitter constructor equals events event emitter. Useless line. I could, you know, just as well say eventer equals new event emitter. Typically, you'll see people put this at the end of it. Because a little known secret is that if you use the new, you don't have to do that. I don't know why. It was bad of me not to. It was bad of me not to put it up there. That's probably confusing. Because essentially it is calling a function. Questions back there? Based on user input, and I could build an object for the user that contains information about it, and maybe I give that user their own event emitter so that I know when that user does something.
So is eventer a variable in that case?
Yeah.
So why is there a reason why you wouldn't do like var eventer?
Lazy.
Okay.
So that's what I got called out.
So in other words, it's a JavaScript piece and object on the variable. That's what it was saying.
Every object is a variable?
Did you claim that as a variable?
Yeah. So in Node,
like the user submission or hover.
Yeah. So that on the front end, in short, this is the simple script that you're looking at right here. A more real world example is like callback would be, it's a couple of things. It's information about the event, metadata about the event, and it is go time for your function. Because you're like, ah, click that event, release the sample, face hits or something. So that's events and callbacks, as best as I can give it to you. And yeah, any other questions? Time. Oh, question.
As best as I can think of it, that I typically thought that an event would be something that was generated by a user, but I see also here that there's an event that's generated by the program itself, which is an event that's classed based on time, the set timeout. So this is a time-based. I mean, I imagine that the time set timeout sets an event that it gets dispatched after a specific amount of time.
Set timeout is built in. It's built in to JavaScript, and I'm not sure how that works. It's I'm not sure how that works. Set timeout. Which is to say that set timeout does not use event emitters as the base class. Like event emitter is the base class for events in Node, not in the browser, but Node. Well, you can use these in the browser. And set timeout doesn't use that. But as I mentioned in the docs over here, was that a connection is an event. Update and on the abstract level, an interval is an event. Yeah. If you're programming with intervals, they're probably important. Sometimes if I'm writing a music program and I'm setting intervals, essentially what I'm doing is setting timers for a specific time, for specific intervals, and saying those are the events. And when that happens, I know X amount of time has passed. It's time to play a note again. Or it's time to pause.
The completion of a function or the execution of a function would be an event also. I guess that's what a callback is.
The callback is when you know that the event has happened. If you dig into like libraries, especially like node libraries, stuff on NPM and start reading code, you'll see a lot of stuff like sort of like meta events, like One particular example might be you're writing a backend for a website. The user comes and uploads a big file to it, and on the backend you've got a server that's just sitting around humming, and then somebody comes to the website and posts a big file to it. And it's like, oh, I got a server connection. What do I do? Expect a file, and then. I got the file. File starts. Start ingesting the file, whatever. You might write a program that's like, I want to know when that file is done being ingested. And probably the person who wrote like the library they're using has built that sort of metadata in there. So you can listen to it. You can say, oh, cool. Let me know when the file has been completely written to disk, because now I know that I can, make a full duplicate of the file, or I can perform some action on the file. I can turn it upside down and send it back or something like that. So you've got these other events like process finished, process started. But a callback is a good way to say when a function has ended. But I don't know if that's really done now.
Can you talk about the required functionality? Because it seems to be the first line, it's just like a magic trick. The object where you're taking a module and shooting it into a variable.
Yeah, we'll be I'm not going to cover that today.
Okay.
It is a certain amount of magic. It's definitely something that you're going to want to know about. His question was, if you didn't hear, what's up with this require stuff? This is node convention. This is just how. This is so that I can write one one-page example and not a giant example. Well, that's not just what it's for. But we'll get into that later. These are modules, and they make up everything. And now, you can all stand up, greet one another, shake each other's hands.
Okay, thanks.